We can see quite clearly that we think that that bullish macro has run out of room. And this is going back to Sunday night's tweet, Sunday night, the 28th of January. So we were preferring to sell the upticks on Monday. Well, it opened gap up on Monday. Well, that's pretty good uptick, right? It opened gap up. You can see there was plenty of opportunities to recognize areas that might generate some liquidity into certain opens, certain top lines, certain pullbacks into these upticks, these kind of areas that might generate something for us. And obviously the outcome was, well brilliant. I mean, it was a brilliant trade outcome, getting all the way down into this very, very heavy volume that was obviously marking the arrival of the end of trend at that stage. And that was Monday's business done. That was quite clearly Monday's business from Sunday night. Well, last night, of course, we did even better. We gave an exact price. And we said, of course, here that we had this fair value of 76 by the swap dealers. And we're therefore holding on to the idea of selling pullbacks. So you could have taken a series of opportunities in the overnight session. You can see we were bullish RGL, so we had to be careful. And obviously, we're making higher highs here. So that means that we have to be aware that we are making higher highs. May not seem like a statement that's worthy of mentioning, but it's very important because higher highs means fair value. And therefore, if we're going to sell this, we've got to get higher highs. When it starts to jam at lower highs, we can now take action. Higher highs, lower highs, we can now take action. Lower highs, we can take action. Lower highs, we can take action. And that's allowed us to get a 77.30 press down to 76s. And in fact, it went a little bit beyond 76s for ultimately over $1,000 on that short sell. And when we think about these, it's kind of interesting to note, it's not about any one specific trade, is it? I mean, we've got to go around the charts looking, but even if we sold liquidity highs in swings, you could say, well, you could have got a swing into this liquidity high here and got short, and you would still have made money. You could have got that level two there, and you would still have made money on that swing. You could have obviously might not have got anything on this one because it never really went very far, but it's still a pullback, and that's what we're talking about, selling pullbacks into top edges, into the right time of the day, starting to build into the right time of the day, selling top edges, coming into the top of the hour, selling top edges, coming into the US Open, and we're already at our target of 76, and that's before the US markets even got to their desk. So when we come to that idea there, it's crystal clear what we're expecting. It's crystal clear what we should be trying to do from a macro perspective. And this is important because you'll be able to recognize that there's been plenty of buy arrows during this trade as well. There's plenty of little opportunities to buy for the flip or buy for the press or buy for the whatevers. But the idea is we have a macro view. And that macro view is to be short. The macro view is to try and sell it. The macro view is to try work hard as we can to be on the short side for that macro view to work. Because macro is exactly that. It's a macro view chart. It's not about what happens on this little swing here or this little swing here or this one here or this one here. It's about what happens on this page. And on this page, we have a fair value of 76. Just like on this page here, we've got a fair value, which is way lower than 79. Unfortunately, I never had a fair value at that stage, but it's a sell on pullbacks. So we know that on this page, we should see the price dropping. And my goodness, did it drop. $2,400 per contract on the swing is a pretty good drop. So even if you took the one trade and out, it was still a massive monster profit, considering that we'd been macro bullish from 71 from the week before, and it was trading at 79 by the time we got the big sell side flip. We'd made $8,000 the week before. We've already done $3,700 this week on swings. That takes you over $11,000 in the last 10 days just trading the big swings. So get your macro view right. And when we fit that idea into the macro view, we also have the ability to highlight the micro view. And this is that order flow trade that we're going to be looking at in classroom. When we look at order flow trades, of course, this is a great example of what we were talking about earlier. The idea that this buy here fails to make an auction. So we have a weak buyer here, don't we? So if we've got a weak buyer in that location there, the sell that comes in here with that buy delta presses the market. We've got a bottom edge here, so we've got a weak buyer again, haven't we? So we've got a weak buyer, so when that sell comes in there against the delta, we've got another sell opportunity. It's not as high as it was before. So when we get another sell coming in against that buy delta, we've got another weak buy opportunity just right beside the same one as the last time. We've got another weak buy opportunity to go against that trader. This one is fair. Doesn't look very fair, but you know, we're using the idea of a red candle to give us the unfairness on a specific candle. This one is very, very unfair, and we've got a weak buyer to go after here. That's four trades in about 15 minutes. Four trades in 15 minutes. We went from 32 to a low price there of 12. That's $200 on that one. We went from 24 to a low price of about 12 again here. So that's about another 100. So when you're starting to add these up, 200, 100, 100, 100, that should have done $500 on pressing the weak buying trades. $500. If you're a five lot trader, you've just done $2,500 in about 15 minutes, just simply pressing weak buyers or weak sellers. How are we identifying them? We're looking at basic market structure. So it comes back to the interns exercise, doesn't it? So when we look at the interns exercise, if I see a selling candle coming in with a buying delta and it's below the previous peak that broke structure, it's a sell trade. When I see a selling candle coming in with a buying delta coming in, and it's obviously we broke structure here, so the new peak is this price, well, we're going after the weak buyer. When I see a selling candle coming in against a buying delta and it's below the next peak, then of course I'm going to go after the press. When I see a selling delta coming in against a buying delta coming in against a selling candle and it's lower than the previous peak, we're going to go after the weak buyer. $2,500 on a five lot just there, $500 on a single contract just there, just by taking the trade against the weak traders like an algorithm. These are incredibly algorithmic trade responses. They are incredibly easy to spot. It's a red candle with an uptick in the delta. There's a red candle. It doesn't happen anywhere else, but there's a red candle with an uptick in the delta prior to that level pressing into a weak buyer. There's a red candle with an uptick in delta. This one doesn't have. This is an uptick in the delta, but it's a green candle, so no trade, right? This one does have. It's an uptick in delta. It's a red candle. We're pressing the liquidity again. And you can see that that process allows me to go with the macro trend that we were already trading. So it's not just a $1,300 swing. It's a multiple $1,000 swing. And these are the trades that should make up how much? 60, 70, 80% of all your trades should be these types of trades if you're trading like a professional. I challenge you to look at your trade log and see how many trades you took pressing weak traders and how many trades you took trying to buy and sell bottom top edges. I would imagine your percentages are going to be slightly different from that 70, 80% percentage. I'd imagine it's probably skewed on the other side. It's going to be 70 or 80%. So the key to that is that you've got to be able to recognize it, right? So when you've got that as an idea, all you've got to do is take the trades in line with your idea. That's literally all you've got to, that's all you've got to do, Jason, is take your trades in the direction of your original idea. So when I see that I am bearish oil, well, this is all I'm looking for then if I'm going to go for that press. Because if I'm bearish oil, the buyers have got nowhere to go. If I'm bearish oil still in here, the buyers have got nowhere to go. So they can't spread it. They can't hedge it. And if they can't spread it or hedge it, they can only stop it out, right? That's the only choice they've got. If I've got the ability because of a pairs trade to be able to hedge out this position, I won't stop my position out here, and that'll stop the price from rolling down. And that's what we're counting on, is to line this up with our understanding of where the value is in that short term. And if you've got the ability to recognize a red candle with a buy delta or a green candle with a sell delta, and I'm sure you do, and that candle forms prior to the takeout of the previous pivot high or the previous pivot low, and I'm sure you can all do that, then you've got an opportunity to trade with the macro. And that is getting that sell press in, getting that sell press in, getting that sell. What was the drawdown on these sell presses? It was about one tick. Literally, there was no trade in that sequence there that was any more than a single tick drawdown. And yet you were able to make about $500 a contract just in that little sequence. Okay, it's a good sequence, but that's why I wanted to take a screenshot of it, was so that you could all recognize what a good sequence looks like of pressing this trade. And if the delta ever kind of takes over, well, you know that it's time to stop doing the press, don't you? There's no trade here. There's no trade here. You can see why there's no trade here or here or here, because the delta doesn't line up with the trade. But this delta does here, this delta does here, this delta does here, and this delta does here. And when the delta does, you do, right? I mean, that's pretty much all you can ever say. When the delta does, you do. So you do that when the delta does. Brilliant trades, lovely outcomes, pretty straightforward stuff. We talked about the idea of doing this type of charting in classroom this morning, and the idea was to do the charting on a delta chart, which you can obviously do on your Sierra charts, no problem, or whatever. And you can see, for example, that it's not just about oil, it's about any market you're going to be trading on a failed auction, any failed auction. Take a look at this oil trade here that just took place. Is that a failed auction, this candle here? So we get a failed auction, don't we? We get a failed auction on this candle here. And we're obviously now looking at this area, and we say we now know that there's an opportunity, because that is a failed auction when the delta's away up above where it was before and the price isn't. And what I was hoping to see was obviously a red candle there. Unfortunately, we never got a red candle at that stage, but it was pretty obvious you were going to go after this weak buyer here. So obviously you could have got that press on at some stage. Now, the challenge, of course, was we didn't get the perfect candle, and that's unfortunate. It is just what it is. We got an imbalance. We got a lean. We could have taken a swipe at it because we know how to do this, but on that occasion, we didn't get the perfect candle type to get the deal done at that point. And that's just unfortunate. What about this auction here? We've got a red candle here on a buyer's auction here. That's not taking out the high price, is it? So we're going to go after this guy. So that is a correct candle. See that red candle there? That red candle's got a buy delta on it. So that's a valid press candle. I can sell that candle, draw down of zero, and you can see what happened to that trade. We got a brilliant little sell from 76.04s to 75.86s. It's not quite 20 ticks, but it's not that far off it, and it only takes you approximately 6 minutes to make a few hundred dollars. Few hundred dollars, right? And it's a very systematic trade because you're asking a very simple question. So let's deal with that very simple question. Is this a lower delta than it was here? Yes or no? Is that delta lower than that delta? Is the price lower? If the price isn't lower, but that delta is lower, I can go after the weak seller at the top edge, right? I can go after the weak seller. So when I'm looking at that, do I find a green candle absorption type trade to lean against? Well, we kind of get a little candle that goes absolutely nowhere, so it's technically not green or red, but yeah, we do. So I don't buy that candle. I buy above it. I buy when it's trapped. Well, I buy when it's there. And I go for the press and I make easy money, which then switched into a sell trade in here for that press and made some easy money, which then switched to a sell trade in here, which then went for that press and made some easy money. And we go after these deltas all the time. We go after these deltas when the value is in our favor. We go after these deltas when we can see them. This is what I'm saying. There is an easy trade. And sometimes that easy trade doesn't always line up with your value lines. But there's always an easy trade. In front of the delta is the easy trade. So in other words, this is an easy trade here. This is an easy trade here. And this is an easy trade here. Because even if I'm bullish on these last two trades, I won't be buying until I take out the prior swing lows. So we've got an easy trade towards the prior swing lows. There's always an easy trade option on every single chart. There's an easy trade here, right? This green candle makes this an easy trade. Now, there's no structure to this. But if you're going to go anywhere, I'm going to be long, right? If I'm going to go anywhere, I'm going to go long there. Because if I'm bearish, I'm not going to be bearish probably, one would imagine, until the price takes out that liquidity. So on the basis that the buying is in, and we can see it, I can buy this now to at least get to that price and see what happens. There is always an easy option. Always. And sometimes I'm going to like them, and sometimes I'm not going to like them, but I'm always going to be able to recognize them. Sometimes I'll trade them, and sometimes I'll not trade them, but I'll always be able to recognize them. That's why we spent the whole of January looking at getting in front of the delta, getting behind the delta. If we were fading into top edge exhaustions, getting behind the delta. So this is what we're going to be focusing on again, is to make sure everybody can see those. And obviously that charting type is a 25 delta chart, right? So it only charts on 25 delta. That's why the delta looks very uniform compared to the likes of these charts, where the delta is very, very very kind of randomly generated around the chart itself. It's been a beautiful trade. It's been a beautiful day. We had a lot of money today. And even the trades that we've shown in Ninja Trader are doing pretty good. This is the trades we've shown in Ninja Trader so far. You can see that we've got $6,600 so far on the trades that we've shown so far on Ninja Trader. That's not a bad outcome considering the average trade size being between 3 and 5 contracts. So not a bad start to the morning session, guys. Not a bad start to your day session. So let's see how it continues to develop.